So a black hole is a very dense object in space. So dense to the point where almost infinite density, infinite mass in a very, very small area, to the point where even light can't escape from it. So if you're within the event horizon, you cannot escape from a black hole.
So we know nowadays that black holes are not only mathematical obstruction of the theory, but they are astrophysical objects. And we know actually in the universe now there are at least a couple of tens of black holes in our galaxy with a mass comparable to the mass of our sun, or slightly larger, 10 times, 20 times larger. And what we call supermassive black holes, probably at the center of every galaxy, with a mass comprised between 1 million and 1 billion times the mass of a sun. If we are able actually to pinpoint, discover and identify black holes very far away in the universe, we have a very powerful tool to study the evolution of the galaxy across the whole history of the universe, from the earliest stage when galaxy formed to the local universe, to nowadays.
So if you have two of these black holes and they happen to come close to each other, they eventually can get caught in each other's gravity. And at that point, they start to spiral, and they get closer and closer and closer, and eventually they merge together, forming a single object. But the gravity of a black hole is so strong, it actually warps space. Well, all mass warps space, but black holes warp it to a very high degree. And so when two of these objects get very close together, we end up having ripples formed in space-time. And those ripples propagate out throughout the whole universe. These are what we call gravitational waves. So up until today, we've measured gravitational waves coming from small objects. When I say small, it's anywhere between about 1 to 100 times the mass of a sun. So very, very big astrophysical objects. But in the future, we want to be measuring gravitational waves coming from supermassive black holes. So not two small black holes smashing together, but two galaxies coming together. And when two galaxies come together, you have black holes in the order of a million solar masses smashing into each other. And we're going to do that using the LISA mission, which is a European Space Agency future mission for gravitational wave detection. So LISA will be looking for primarily supermassive black holes smashing together. One thing we should say with LISA is you can't point it. It's more like a microphone than a telescope. So it measures everything at the same time. So if two supermassive black holes merge anywhere in the universe, LISA will see it. So when two small black holes, like the ones measured by LIGO, when they're formed, they're just formed as individual objects. And those objects then get caught with each other and they eventually merge. But we don't expect much gas to be in the vicinity. However, if you get two galaxies merging, then you've got the entire galactic disk coming together. So you now have two black holes surrounded by an enormous amount of gas. At that point, as a black hole spiral together, they're also pulling the gas. And so as well as getting the gravitational wave signature coming from the black holes merging, we may also get an electromagnetic signature.
Athena is the next large X-ray observatory of the European Space Agency. It will be the largest X-ray mission and probably the largest mission that ESA is going to build. And the goal of Athena is investigating with unprecedented accuracy and depth the X-ray universe. So, in particular, Athena is going to measure a very high number of black holes, several hundred thousand of black holes from very nearby to very far away in the universe, so in the early phase of the evolution of the universe. And in particular, with Athena, we are interested at those black holes that are the oldest, so the one that formed the first in the history of the universe, one few hundred million years after the Big Bang. When two galaxies merge, eventually many things happen. We know the gas and the dust in the galaxy merge. There are lots of shocks, lots of turbulence. But as far as the black holes are concerned, eventually and inevitably they will coalesce. They will merge and one bigger black hole will be formed from the two black holes at the center of the galaxies. At that point, many interesting things happen. One of the most interesting is the fact that the merging, that the process of spiraling and then merging creates gravitational waves, which is what we hope to be able to detect with LISA. And also the matter, so the gas and dust surrounding these black holes, will start moving depending on the warps and the changes of the space-time induced by the spiraling black holes. So we will have a unique opportunity of making another test of how matter behaves due to the general relativity prediction, due to the force of gravity, in a unique environment that has never been tested before, where the space-time is particularly strongly steered due to the fact that you have two black holes spiraling around each other.
Now, X-ray signature can be measured by Athena, and LISA measures the gravitational waves, and together we get everything. We get the environment of the black holes. We get the black hole mass, the environment, the location. It really just gives a whole wealth of information you can't get with one or the other instruments.
So these are unique observational opportunities that will be possible only if we have both Athena and LISA operating together at least for a few years.
LISA will be able to measure the two black holes coming towards each other, maybe up to about a month before they actually merge together. At that point, we won't really know where they are. We'll just know somewhere in the universe, these two objects exist. As our LISA detector goes around the sun, we can start to pinpoint where it is. It doesn't have to move very far. So then we can start to narrow down where the object actually is. Just before it actually merges, we'll get it down to an area of about maybe 1 square degree, maybe 10 square degrees, which is still huge compared to other instruments. But at that point, we can then point Athena to the same area, and Athena can start to scan the sky of where we think this object is. And we have a very characteristic signature we're looking for. As the two black holes are orbiting, they stream matter from the surrounding gas, and that modulates the X-rays. So we can look for the gravitational wave signature, and we can look for the corresponding X-ray signature. And with that, we can try to nail down exactly which object, which galaxy, is producing the signal.
And eventually, the localization, at least for some of the best signal-to-noise event, will be so good that we will be able to stare with Athena in the exact position of the merging, see the merging, and see what happens afterwards. And at that point, magic happens, we hope at least. We will be able to see how an active galactic nucleus, so an accreting black holes, is born. So we will see how X-ray emission from an accreting black holes start actually emerging through the Athena observations. And this will be a unique opportunity to know how actually the accreting black holes are born, starts emit lights, and this can tell us a lot, for instance, on how relativistic jets, which we know are a very powerful component in the universe that we see in different kind of astrophysical environments, are born.
I think this is one of the most interesting measurements we could ever make. At the moment, we know gravitational waves exist from the ground-based. We know supermassive black holes exist from galaxies, and we know that some galaxies are very active in X-rays, called active galactic nuclei, with jets, very high-energy jets coming off of the central black hole. What we don't know is how do these jets actually turn on. So by measuring the two black holes as they merge together, it's called the in-spiral phase, we really start to understand the dynamics of the center of a galaxy during this. After they merge, we may actually see the jet turning on. If we see an active galactic nuclei actually turn on in real time, that would just be amazing.